of the meeting come to order. General Faulk will lead us in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mr. Chair.
Councilman Musket.
I'd like to see if we can have a moment of silence for the loss of life in Orlando and the service personnel who lost their lives at Fort Hood during the flood.
Absolutely. Moment of silence. Thank you, Councilman. Tonight, Councilman Tom Berry will not be here. He's tending to a critically ill family member. Please keep Councilman Berry and his family in your thoughts and your prayers. And I understand the mayor will not be with us this evening either.
Thank you.
Mr. Clerk, do you want to call the roll? And then we'll do the presentations.
Dave Abdallah.
Here.
Thomas Berry is absent. Robert Constant.
Here.
Lisa Hicks Clayton.
Here.
Margaret Horvath.
Here.
Joseph Kosinski.
Here.
Ray Muscat.
Here.
Mr. Chairman, we have a quorum.
Thank you. Councilman Abdallah, you have, on behalf of the mayor, a presentation to make from the owners of Alamir Restaurant being awarded the James Beard Award.
Let me go over there.
Yes.
And Robert, you should go up there in place of the mayor.
Yes, there I will.
Good evening.
Come on up.
Well, I was asked to do this on behalf of the mayor. So on behalf of the mayor of Dearborn Heights, the city of Dearborn Heights, the residents of Dearborn Heights, and the honorable city council, I'd like to award this to Alamir Restaurant. Now they have three locations, ours in Dearborn Heights on Ford Road, and they have one in Dearborn on Warren Avenue, and then a new one in Canton. They've been awarded, and I'm gonna read this. This is an award from the city of Dearborn Heights. In the world of culinary arts, there is a distinction that stands out among all. In 1990, the James Beard Foundation Award was created to honor the culinary professionals for their excellence and achievement. On this day, May 2nd, 2016, Dearborn Heights Alamir Restaurant became Michigan's first restaurant to receive this prestigious award. Therefore, let it be known that on behalf of the city of Dearborn Heights, we are honored to recognize the achievement and reserve May 2nd, 2016 as Alamir Day in the city of Dearborn Heights. This is from Mayor Dan Paletko and the city council. And I'd like to congratulate Alamir Restaurant. I've always known they're one of the better Middle Eastern restaurants, and now it's been proven.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Where's the food?
It's Ramadan.
Oh, that's right.
Best coffee around, I'll tell you that right now.
Good evening, City Council, City Clerk Pruszewicz, City Treasurer John Riley, those in the audience, and those watching home via TV. On June 1st through the 5th, the Dearborn Heights celebrated our 30th annual Spirit Festival, and I know I was before you when I was promoting it and hoping for great outcomes, and I am very pleased to announce that we achieved those outcomes. In fact, we outdid last year's attendance by about 10%, even though we had rain on Saturday night, which is our largest attended evening, and we delayed the opening on Sunday to 2:00 in the afternoon also because of rain. Even with those challenges, Friday night turned out to be the largest attended Friday in the history of Spirit, and as good as Friday was, Saturday, even with the rain, still had greater attendance than Friday. So I think it was real successful, and it could have been unbelievably successful if indeed we would have had perfect weather. But you can never, ever expect perfect weather for 5 days in Michigan. So I think we did pretty good, and we're very pleased with that. Tonight, what I'm here to do, I won't have a report for you, other than I think it'll be a very positive report when I do get all the numbers together. We're still putting those numbers together, and I will have a report at the next council meeting on the financial outcome of Spirit. But to achieve this, it does take an army. And I mean that sincerely. It's not a small group of people. It takes a real commitment by a community. And I'm very proud that in the 30 years, this has probably been the finest commitment I've seen from this city in regards to putting on this event. It ran flawlessly, if that's possible, from a professional programmer of over 40 years. We had no incidences that I heard of, and that goes from security to people being dissatisfied. I heard no negativity. All I saw were a lot of people out there enjoying themselves and enjoying Dearborn Heights hospitality. But what I'd like to do is recognize all the individuals so people in the community will understand what it takes to put on an event like this. It just doesn't happen. It's an effort. It starts with the mayor and council, with all the support you do in approving the budgets and approving all the different things that you have to put your rubber stamp on so we can proceed. We get great cooperation from both bodies, and we do thank you. From our Department of Public Works that installs all the 4x8 signs that lets the public know that we're having an event, that's a very effective way of communicating to our public, and it's the DPW that takes care of that. Our police department and our reserves providing security at the event and being proactive and not reactive. Many events, I see police being reactive. What does that mean? They wait until something happens and then they take care of it. Our police are constantly managing the crowd, moving, looking and surveying the area, and therefore they're being proactive, and I think that's why we're successful in the area of that, and I do commend our police department. Our fire department, who provided round-the-clock first aid. I don't know of any other event where they have their fire department and their professional firefighters union volunteering, not paid, but volunteering. From the time we open up till we close, we have a first aid tent, and you can't get any better than our fire department and our staff, and they're trained. And the way they approach it. Nice report. I think they just gave out a couple Band-Aids and took a couple photos. So that was the good news. Our city controller, who processes all our requests for checks that we need, and we do need some last-minute checks sometimes, and we need it like either that day or the next day, and they really have fast turnaround. And then, of course, they work with our city treasurer, because once it goes to the controller, then it has to go to the city treasurer, who actually issues the check. And so we get great cooperation from everybody there. Our building department, with all the inspections they do, that's being proactive again. They come out, check the grounds, check both sides of the equation, both the carnival company and our side, to make sure that we don't have any trip hazards, we don't have any electrical issues, and of course, the outcome is very positive because of that. Our building and maintenance department, I cannot speak any higher of. Those guys are on the grounds. They're by my side from the start, when we open up, to when we close, and taking care of all those really unnoticed things, like emptying our trash cans, or cleaning of tables, or doing all the special setups that we have to have. And we do have quite a few, and they do it without complaining. And in fact, it's really nice, because they're actually one step ahead of me. And that's great as the chairman, when you don't have to constantly be managing people all the time, that they understand what has to be done, and they just get it done. And then on my own recreation department, my office staff, Tammy and Susan, who work effortlessly behind the scenes, and then Kim Constant and my deputy director, who works by my side. So that's quite a crew. We also get help from the Crestwood National Honor Society. They come out and help out at the Taste Fest, all the different school groups that provide free, entertainment on Thursday night. So there's just a lot of giving. The service clubs that come out and are part of the event, and all our sponsors and the business community who donate food for the Taste Fest. I can go on and on. And so that's a real commitment, and I think that's a positive image that we would like to see in Dearborn Heights. And I think the Spirit Festival, that's what it's kind of all about. It just promotes Dearborn Heights and kind of lets people know who we really are. And I think for 5 days we're able to get a good, really good snapshot. But last but not least, I'd like to introduce the people that I work with, and that's my Spirit Festival Committee, and that's what was on the agenda. So we'll get to that right now. First person I'd like to introduce is our chairman of the Parks and Recreation Commission, who takes care of the adult beverage area. He's been on the committee for 20 years, and that's Marty O'Sullivan. Marty? Who handles the Taste Fest, my wife for going to be 25 years, and I think a member of the committee for at least, we're guessing somewhere, we didn't keep track as Marty did, I did with Marty, because I know when Marty got on the Recreation Commission, so it was easy to track, but I think it's about 18 years, pretty close that she's been heading up the Taste of the Heights and working with all the restaurants and pulling off that event, which is a great fundraiser for us, and that's my wife, Peggy Greibel. Next, the deputy director, she's been there 29 years for the city of Dearborn Heights, Kim Constant. We've been partners. She handled all the volunteer food concessions. We had the North Dearborn Heights baseball, the firemen had a concession for the first time this year, and the Redskins football program has, so she works with them and makes sure that they are taken care of and all their needs are attended to. Next is Mike Henniger, who took care of our parking detail, all our different parking lots. And the last gentleman who I want to introduce, because he's been with me since we started this thing back in 87 and has been the only member the entire 30 years other than myself, and that's Jerry Willems, but unfortunately for some reason he's not here. He told me he's 80... Was he 82, 83? And he told me that he talked to his doctor, and his doctor said, how many more years does Ken Greibel have to go? And he said, I think he's going to look at three or four more. He goes, I think you can finish with him. So that's kind of his goal. So he assured me that he's going to be around until at least I go. So and we're going to make sure that he is. And he does a great job. He handles all the entertainment. He schedules all the entertainment and negotiates the contract. That's your festival committee. Like I said, I will have a financial report. I think you'll be pleased with it. And I thank you all once again for everybody's efforts.
Thank you. Thank you. Next, we have a proclamation from the City of Dearborn Heights honoring Brigadier General Rodney Falk to be presented by State Senator David Kinesic and State Representative Julie Plucky. Do you want to come up? And Councilwoman Lisa X. Clayton.
Well, good evening, everyone. So I got a text message a couple weeks ago from a very dear friend of mine, Joe over here. And quite literally, Joan has known me for the 30 years that I've been alive, was a maintenance man over at St. Linus when I was in school over there. And he said, David, we've got a Dearborn Heights resident who was just promoted to the rank of Brigadier General. And we thought, what a phenomenal achievement, what a phenomenal accomplishment for one of our own here in the community. And so after speaking with Joe, Lisa Hicks Clayton, Councilwoman, and other members of the council, we decided that we wanted to do something to recognize Brigadier General Falk and his phenomenal achievement. And so normally I don't read these tributes, but seeing as it's such an auspicious occasion, I would hope that you could bear with me as I read through the tribute before we make the presentation to the general. And so it's a special tribute from the state of Michigan to Brigadier General Rodney Falk of the United States Army. I don't hold that against you, sir. Let it be known, it's the Marine in me, I'm sorry, yeah. Let it be known that in grateful recognition for his exceptional leadership and service to our country that we honor Mr. Rodney Falk on his promotion to the rank of Brigadier General in the United States Army. A native of Battle Creek, Michigan, Brigadier General Falk has dedicated nearly his entire adult life to serving our nation with honor and distinction. Beginning in college, Brigadier General Falk was a member of the Reserve Officer Training Corps at Western Michigan University, where he earned his bachelor's degree in business administration with distinction in 1987. Brigadier General Falk's ethical and honest leadership style allowed him to ascend the ranks from platoon leader to deputy commanding officer. He has served in posts in Battle Creek, Ann Arbor, Inkster, Fraser, Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, and in the Iraq Theater. Great loyalty and a strong sense of service has marked Brigadier General Faulk's personal and professional life. He earned his master's degree in business administration from Wayne State University in 1993 and graduated from the United States Army War College in 2009. In 2011, Brigadier General Faulk was inducted into the Western Michigan University ROTC Wall of Fame. In 2013, he was recognized as a distinguished alumni from Western Michigan University Haworth College of Business Development and Management. Brigadier General Faulk's military awards and decorations include the Bronze Star Medal with Oak Leaf Cluster, the Defense Meritorious Service Medal, the Meritorious Service Medal with one silver and one bronze oak leaf cluster, the Army Commendation Medal with one silver and two bronze oak leaf clusters, the Army Achievement Medal with one oak leaf cluster, and the Order of the Marechaussee in bronze. Clearly, Brigadier General Faulk's record of service is deserving of acclaim. In special tribute, therefore, this document is signed and dedicated to Mr. Rodney Faulk as he ascends to the rank of Brigadier General in the United States Army. And that tribute is on behalf of myself, as well as State Representative Julie Plawecki and Governor Rick Snyder of the state of Michigan. Congratulations, General.
I was talking to the Brigadier General, and I've never said that before because I've never met one, but I was talking to him beforehand, and he was telling me how he was all set to retire. He was checking off the boxes. He had the retirement party, but the Army knows a good thing when they've got it. And so they called him up and said that he was now going to be a Brigadier General. They were not going to let him go. So obviously you are a fabulous person to be doing this because they are not letting you go. And I am so pleased and so honored to be here and present this to you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Well, General Faulk, we're happy you're here with us this evening. On behalf of the City of Dearborn Heights, Mayor Daniel Pleco, and the City Council, we are pleased to acknowledge and recognize your promotion to Brigadier General. You're very active in our community, which we appreciate. I know we see you often at different veteran ceremonies, as well as St. Hedwig Memorial each year. You're an inspiration to us and very moving when you speak. So again, congratulations on behalf of the City of Dearborn Heights.
Thank you. So just briefly, I just want to say thank you so much. I'm very honored to receive this recognition from the council and certainly our state leadership. I would just say you picked a great day. Today is the 241st birthday of the Army. Thank you very much. You know, service is not about self, so I'm accepting this award on behalf of the 195,000 Army Reserve soldiers nationwide and all the millions of soldiers who came before them. So thank you, City Council.
You're welcome.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
The next item on the agenda is the approval of the agenda.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilwoman Lisa X. Clayton.
I move to approve the order of business June 14th, 2016, regular meeting of the Dearborn Heights City Council as presented.
Second.
Second by Councilman Kaczynski. All those in favor, please state aye.
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 The ayes have it. The next item on the agenda is the approval of the minutes of the regular meeting of May 24th, 2016.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilman Kaczynski.
I move that the minutes of the last formal council meeting on May 24th be approved as submitted.
Second.
Second by Councilman Abdullah. All those in favor, please state aye.
Aye. Aye. Aye.
Those opposed, the ayes have it. The next item on the agenda is item six, fund transfers and current claims.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilwoman Horvath.
I move that the council approve current claims 6-1 through 6-40.
Second.
Second by Councilman Kaczynski. Any discussion?
Mr. Chair.
Councilwoman Lee-Six Clayton.
I'm sorry. Okay. Thank you. Just real quick note on item 6-1. I had a question about this, but I did speak with Director Zimmer. I don't know if that needs to be changed under the description on the cover. The concrete work is, it's listed on the cover as fire station, and it was done at City Hall, which is correct in the invoice on the backside. Does that need to be corrected on the front? That's for probably the comptroller, right?
Well, it's still going to be the same account number.
Okay. All right. Very good.
It doesn't change the account number.
All right. Thank you.
Any further discussion?
Mr. Chair.
Councilman Musket.
I was going to comment on 6-9, but since the mayor isn't here, I'd like to pass that along, but I just wanted on the record that I have a question that I guess we can, I think we need the mayor here to ask.
Yeah, and we are going to be scheduling a study session next week on the whole issue of negotiations.
And one other, if you don't mind, items 614 and 615 for E&N Cement. I just got a question. Is E&N Cement the only contractor? I mean, do we ever go out for bid and see if anybody is any cheaper to do any of this work? And
Director Zimmer?
Yeah, we have. I have gone through the Mitten system and looked at competitive pricing for other communities that have gone out for bids, and they have been at par or less.
Okay.
He is not the only contract. We also have A-Land Cement, who does pretty much sidewalk and drive approach.
All right. Thank you very much, Mr.
Chairman.
Mr. Chair. Councilwoman Horvath.
Could I? I think I had the same question, only I think I called around and got the answer to 6-9, the $5,000. And I don't know if this is your question, Councilman. If you recall, we discussed several times having an outside source at all contract negotiations, whether it was 5 minutes or 5 hours, and this is a result of it. If you look at all of these charges, it's all has to do with the negotiations. So that's what I found out.
That was part of my question, okay. But the other question, I think the mayor needs to respond to them. So I'll wait.
Okay.
Out of respect for him, I would rather have him answer the questions that I have.
Okay.
Any further
Mr.
questions?
Chairman.
Sure.
I'm sorry,
Councilman
I think
Abdullah.
She was first. Go ahead.
No, you go ahead. You were next.
Okay. Got a question for Director Zimmer in regards to items number 6-7 and 6-8. And I just wanted clarification. There's charges here for truck parts and supplies and various invoices. And on the next one, on 6-8, it's also for auto and truck parts. And it's charged to the water fund. The question to you is, are these truck parts and supplies that were for the water department, or what's the reason it's charged to the water fund?
These are likely under a water department blanket account. If the parts are used in repair of vehicles for other departments, those parts, along with labor, are charged out to those individual departments through the comptroller.
Okay, thank you.
We get a monthly report from them.
Right.
That the parts and what department they are charged to.
Okay.
That's when the journal entry are made.
Okay, and I had another one. Thank you. I had another one on 6-21. And I just wanted to get a clarification from I believe this was the police chief here. Make sure here.
The fire chief.
From Chief Gavin. This is in regards to, where is that? Is he here?
He's here.
Oh, he must have went someplace. Okay. So maybe Vince, if you don't mind, maybe you might be able to answer that. This was in regards to the car, where the car had been totaled and we received $15,675 for the car and it was cleared, and then I guess we're paying an additional $2,018 from the repair and maintenance account. And I just wanted to get a little bit more of a clarification on that situation. Is this a car that's obviously still usable? What's the general status?
Well, I'd have to assume it is. I mean, the chief could answer that. I can't really. All I can tell you is we got $15,000 in from the insurance company. The repair is 17 and some change. So we took the 15 from the insurance plus 2,000 from the general fund to pay for the repair.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilwoman Lisa Clayton.
Thank you. Item claim 6-3. This is Alliance of Rouge Communities, which is very pleased to see this. And of course, this is a long established alliance. I was looking at the summary of benefits, which are very nice to see. So thank you for this backup. I wanted to ask a question as far as plans for 2016, how we might as a community be using or benefiting from the benefits as stated, like pursuing the grant opportunities, who attends the workshops, there's four workshops, providing plans for community events, public education materials, seasonal posters, education campaigns, especially in regard to stormwater management and our Watershed Stewards Commission.
I know that some of the watershed stewards attend those meetings. Mm-hmm. And I think some of the meetings are attended by Dan Brooks, but I think the mayor would have to answer more specifically. Yeah, Barb Gorka, who's the co-chair of the Watershed Stewards.
Thank you. I think it's a great alliance to be a member of.
Any other discussion? Do we have a motion? Any further questions? All those, the motion was made, wasn't it?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
All those in favor of the motion, please state aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed, the ayes have it. The next item on the agenda is advertisement of bids for Canfield Community Center exterior door entryway replacement project.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilwoman Lisa X. Clayton.
I move to concur with Kenneth Greibel, our Parks and Recreation Director, and approve and authorize the City Comptroller to advertise for bids for the replacement of the exterior doors entryway to the Canfield Community Center. Funds for this project are budgeted and have been budgeted in 2015-2016. Parks and Recreation capital outlay as outlined in 7A.
Is there support?
Support.
Support by Councilman Abdullah. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please state aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed, the ayes have it. The next item on the agenda from Comptroller Vince McCarry, budget amendments for street funds.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilwoman Horvath.
I have a question. Can we take A, B, and C all together, or do they have to be individual?
Mr. Chairman, I would support that thought. A single resolution can cover all of the budget amendments and then break them out separately as individual. Unless the controller
budget
would.
For the
Corporation Council, my thought would be to do them separately, but do you see any problem with doing them?
No, I don't.
We do them all together?
Sure. All right.
That's correct.
Okay, I'll make the motion.
Go ahead.
I move that the council concur with Comptroller McCarry and approve the budget amendments in 9A B, as outlined in 9A, B, and C.
Second.
Second by Councilman Kaczynski. Any discussion?
Mr. Chair.
Councilman Abdullah.
I had a question for Mr. McCarry. The $900,000 here, it says contribution water, and then it's put in again for another $500,000. Could I get
those are two separate funds. The 202 is the Danger Street Fund, and the 203 is the local street fund. Those are basically repairs to the streets that are done by the water fund, and we're able to recapture money from the local major street funds.
Okay, thank you.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please state aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed, the ayes have it. The next item on the agenda, item 9D from City Clerk Walter Pershevitz, budget adjustments for Clerk's Office. Councilman Kaczynski.
I move that council concur with the request of City Clerk Pershevitz and accommodate him with a request of a budget amendment as indicated in item 9D, dated June 2nd, 2016, increasing the appropriate revenue accounts as well as the expense accounts in the amount of $14,600.
Support.
Support by Councilwoman Clayton. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please state aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. The next item on the agenda, item 9E, from Public Service Administrator Bill Zimmer, budget amendments for building maintenance.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilman Kaczynski.
Move council concur with the request of Bill Zimmer, the Public Works Director, and accommodate his request for a budget amendment as indicated in 9E, increasing the revenue and increasing the expense in the amount of $7,000, as indicated in that document dated June 1st, 2016.
Support.
Supported by Councilwoman Clayton. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please state aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? The ayes have it. The next item on the agenda, also from Public Service Director Zimmer, budget amendments for highway departments.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilwoman Clayton.
Yes, thank you. Mr. Chairman, I move to concur with Public Service Administrator William Zimmer, the budget amendment as submitted in 9F.
Second.
Second by Councilman Kaczynski. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please state aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. The next item on the agenda from Public Service Director Bill Zimmer, purchase of laptop and desktop computers.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilman Kaczynski.
I move the council concur with the request of Bill Zimmer, DPW Director, and accommodate his request for, I believe it's three desks and one laptop from Ultra Level. To be distributed amongst the indicated departments as outlined in 9G, item dated May 31st, 2016.
Second.
Second by Councilman Musket. Any discussion?
Mr. Chairman.
Councilman Kaczynski.
It occurs to me that there was a previous such purchase authorized by the City Council. Would it be appropriate to rescind that motion so that there is no open opportunity for any kind of purchasing, or in view of the fact that the equipment is not available, that may not be necessary?
No. Clerk, what's everyone's thoughts on that?
It's not available.
Well, it states it, and you said it's outlined in 9G, mm-hmm. correct?
Yeah.
So I think it covers it all.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's a good point then, all right. I thought perhaps there might be a reason to rescind that motion. If it's not, then we'll move forward with the resolution as it is.
Right. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please state aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? The ayes have it. The next item on the agenda, also from Public Service Director Bill Zimmer, 2015-2016 Street Repair Program Change Order.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilwoman Horvath.
I move that the council approve change order number 2 and payment certificate number 6 in the amount of $605,998.08 to the contract increase reflected in the change order number 2 as outlined in 9H.
Second.
Second by Councilman Kaczynski. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please state aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Those opposed, the ayes have it.
Mr. Chairman, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
I just want to make it known that this is for street repair. Okay.
Thank you. The next item on the agenda from Police Chief Lee Gavin, budget transfer for police department.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilwoman Horvath.
I move that we concur with Chief Gavin and approve the budget transfer from contractual services to overtime is outlined in 9I.
Second.
Second by Councilman Kaczynski. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please state aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Those opposed? The ayes have it. Next item on the agenda from Police Chief Lee Gavin, budget transfer for police department.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilwoman Lisa Hicks Clayton.
I move to concur with Police Chief Lee Gavin and approve the budget amendment as outlined in 9J.
Second.
Second by Councilman Musket. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please state aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. The next item on the agenda from Police Chief Lee Gavin, purchase of body microphones, in-car video monitors.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilwoman Horvath.
I move that the council approve the request for in 24 body microphones and 10 in-car video monitors to replace the failing monitors that are currently installed in the cars at the cost of $14,170.50. This cost will be paid out of the police contractual services account as outlined in 9K.
Second.
Second by Councilman Kaczynski. Any discussion?
Yeah, Mr. Chair.
Councilman Abdullah.
I had a question for the chief. Chief Gavin, in regards to the 24 body microphones, because I know for the 10 in-car video monitors, those were replacing failing monitors. But in regards to the 24 body microphones, are those brand new? Are those replacing old ones? What's the status on those?
Those are new ones that we're adding. Right now, the officers have to share them. When they come in, they turn them in, and the next crew gets them. This way, we're getting them so each officer is assigned one and responsible for their own body mic.
Okay, thank you.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please state aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. The next item on the agenda, also from Police Chief Lee Gavin, in-car mobile radios.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilwoman Clayton.
I'm so sorry, Ray.
And I got it all written down.
You're
here.
Saying, oh, all right.
Go ahead.
Okay. I move to approve the purchase of 5 mobile radios, which allows our police to outfit the new cars with new equipment, as opposed to using outdated equipment. The cost of the equipment is $20,871.85. Payment when invoice is received is outlined in 9L.
Second.
Second by Councilman Musket. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please state aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. The next item on the agenda, also from Police Chief Lee Gavin, purchase of ammunition.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilwoman Horvath.
I move that the council approve the request for purchase of police department ammunition of $5,243, which will come out of the ammunition account as outlined in 9M.
Include 9N.
Pardon?
Mr. Chairman, you might include 9N as a single resolution because of both animal.
Correct. Whatever the council's ammunition. Pleasure.
Same. Yeah, it's the same thing for ammunition coming out. Looks like the same account. I think we could take both of those at the same time.
9M and N.
Oh, yeah. I thought you were saying M&M. I was going to start dancing. Okay, good. That's good.
Is there support for the motion?
Support.
M&M.
Support by Councilman Abdullah. Any discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor of the motion, please state aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. The next item on the agenda, item 9O, also from Police Chief Lee Gavin, video arraignment equipment.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilwoman Clayton.
Okay, I move to concur with Police Chief Lee Gavin and approve the purchase and payment to J. Ewing LLC for new video arraignment equipment. The amount for equipment and the installation total $3,880.95 to be paid from traffic immobilization account as outlined in 9O.
Second.
Second by Councilman Kaczynski. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please state aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? The ayes have it. The next item 9P, also from Police Chief Lee Gavin, replacement of actuators on Justice Center HVAC system.
Mr. Chair.
Councilman Musket.
I move that City Council concur with Chief Gavin for final improvement for the System Temp Corporation for services rendered in the amount of $2,350.65. It will be paid out of the Police Department Contractual Services account. This is for leaks that the HVAC system was leaking from the HVAC system, and they were repaired, and hopefully it's fixed for good.
I support the motion.
Support by Councilwoman Clayton, any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please state aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed, the ayes have it. The next item on the agenda, item 9Q, also from Police Chief Lee Gavin, early warning siren system maintenance.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilman Kaczynski.
Move council concur with the request of Chief Gavin to approve payment for the maintenance of the early warning system equipment in the amount of $1,700. The cost to be divided between police department and fire department.
Second.
Second by Councilman Abdullah. Any discussion? Hearing none. Oh, did you have a comment? Go ahead.
Not significant. There's about a 22-cent differential, but they'll sort it out by percentages.
Thank you. Thank you. Any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor of the motion, please state aye.
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 Those opposed, the ayes have it. The next item on the agenda, also from Police Chief Lee Gavin, wireless access in the Justice Center.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilwoman Clayton.
I move to concur with Police Chief Lee Gavin and approve the purchase and payment to Presidio for providing equipment and installation for wireless access to the Justice Center. Presidio was the lowest bidder. The total is $29,518.80. The court will pay 35%. The remaining 65% will be paid for the police department capital outlay and was budgeted in the current year as outlined in 9R.
Second.
Second.
Second by Councilman Kaczynski. Any discussion?
Mr. Chairman.
Councilman Kaczynski.
I stand corrected. The comment about the 22 cents relates to item 9R. The 22 cent differential and a percentage of dividing the expenses.
Any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor of the motion, please state aye.
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 Those opposed, the ayes have it. The next item on the agenda, also from Police Chief Lee Gavin, network switches for computers at the Justice Center.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilwoman Horvath.
This will conclude the meeting of Chief Lee Gavin.
Thank you, Your Honor.
I move that the council approve the payment upgrade for the network switches for the computers for the entire Justice Center. The total cost is $11,718. The court will pay 35% or $4,101.30, and the remaining 65%, $7,616.70, will be paid from the police department capital outlay, which was budgeted in the current year and is outlined in 9S.
Second.
Second by Councilman Kaczynski. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please state aye.
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 Those opposed, the ayes have it. The next item on the agenda from Police Chief Brogan, purchase of laptop computers.
Fire Chief, Mr. Chair.
Fire Chief.
They may be
Councilwoman Clayton.
All right, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I move to concur with Fire Chief David Brogan and approve the purchase of a Dell Latitude E5470 laptop. The cost is $1,021 from the bid provided by Dearborn IT that is to come out of capital outlay paid upon receipt in item 9T.
Second.
Second by Councilman Musket. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please state aye.
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 Those opposed, the ayes have it. The next item on the agenda from Recreation Director Ken Greibel, Canfield Arena contract extension.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilwoman Horvath.
Is this something that should go back to Gary?
I looked at it. I think that while they negotiate, I mean, it's often just, when a contract runs out, that they extend it until a new contract is negotiated. But Corporate Counsel Miatki?
Yes, I would suggest that it have some sort of end date so that we don't end up having it just continue forever without any sort of notion that there is a need to conclude the negotiations and get something back to the council. So extend the contract for up to, I don't know,
90 days.
90 days.
90 days.
Yes. 6 months, or would 90 days be
90
good?
Days. 90 plenty. Days.
That's how fast we move it along.
I think I think 90 days.
Okay, can I just add that to the motion then?
You can.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, I move that the council grant an extension to Canfield, Inc., operators of the skating inline skating facility, up to 90 days. The current contract extended up to 90 days until the negotiations are completed,
second,
as outlined in 9U.
Second.
Second by Councilman Kaczynski. Any discussion?
Mr. Yes. Chair.
Councilman Musket.
Did you have to say something? Go ahead.
Yes. I think we just need to clarify. The contract would still have to, however, be between, because we don't have a contract with Canfield, Inc. We have a contract right now only with Family Entertainment Properties.
How about putting the existing contract and extend it to 90 days? The same agreement, we would just have to have them sign a document that they are in concurrence. Is that doable? So I'm not sure Family Entertainment really wants to sign it because they're done.
If that's what you mean, and basically what we'd be looking at then is not extending the contract. It would basically be that the contract would end up applying between the city and Canfield, Inc.
All right. You and I can get together.
And I can put together the language. And I think there should be also something in here pursuant to an agreement that meets my approval should be included within the motion.
So you don't think we should just extend the contract with Family Entertainment because they're a subcontractor of?
Canfield is a subcontractor.
Okay.
Actually, they were subcontractor of the Chiefs organization, which was a subcontractor of Family Entertainment Properties. So, I mean, essentially what we're looking at here is something that is a little.
So they're
different.
Like the second or third S&E of the original obligee?
Yes. And so basically what we're looking at here is we need to end up no longer, because Family Entertainment Properties wanted to get out of this. That's why they kept doing the assignment and so on and so forth. And right now, I forgot what the gentleman's name is, but he was here. He came before your meeting, a meeting before, and, you know, showed all the nice things that his firm was doing, even though it was a further assignment of an agreement, which did not necessarily come before this body. So it was a really unusual situation. So that all being said, yes, we should just end up having a new agreement. I'll do a 90-day agreement, essentially take the same agreement that I've done and end up making some changes.
With Canfield, with the new energy.
Canfield, exactly.
So what do you want us to to the motion?
Subject to the Corporation Council's approval.
Okay.
Yes, that we have yes, exactly.
Good. Okay.
Is there support for the motion?
Support.
Any discussion?
Mr. Chair.
Councilman Musket.
I was going to ask some of the questions that our corporate counsel brought up, but not in the way he does it, being an attorney. But I do believe we had something in a study session. I think it was a closed study session about this. And we discussed that we wanted to discuss further on how to go about with this, if I'm not mistaken.
I don't believe we had a closed session on this. I know the gentleman came in front of us a while back, and then that reverted back to corporate counsel to do whatever, to find out how all of these webs are intertwined, but I don't think we ever had a
presentation.
I think the plan going forward is to see if we can get an agreement, and then the recreation director and the new operator are going to come before us and say we'd like you to approve it. So, but yes, we did have several meetings about it.
Yeah, it's there's like too many fingers in a pie here for my liking.
But the operator in there over the Spirit Festival had free skating for anybody who wanted to come in. And any further discussion?
Mr. Chairman,
Councilman Kaczynski.
It occurs to me that there's a time limitation of 90 days. I think it behooves the council to get something done within 60 days. So we put that on the burner up front so that we can get everything in place before the ultimate 90-day period expires.
So Recreation Director Greibel and Councilor Miyake, as soon as you get some type of a firm agreement, you can keep the council informed of what's going on.
Right, and the idea would be that this is a temporary agreement with the idea that a more formal agreement that has perhaps different terms than the current agreement would end up being approved by this body after that 90-day period or during that 90-day period. That's what we'd be looking
right.
at.
Mr. Chair.
Councilman Abdullah.
Can we make sure we have something in there in regards to subleasing? Because the last time, if you recall, they just basically subleased it. I don't know if it was even legal or not legal or if they did something formal or informal. But any type of subleasing has to be with the approval of the
we did.
City Council.
We did.
Okay, but then they subleased to
on their own. Did their own thing,
right?
And that's
so we gotta make sure that the language in there is tight enough to where that's not an option for them, you know, to do that with our approval.
Right. Well, I'll try to make sure, but it was already very tight. They just kind of did what they did in the last.
They called it a management firm, so it's and they couldn't bring it. That's what they did.
But. Right, but if they give it to any type of entity that for whatever reason we are not okay with, then we should have the option to be able to cancel the contract and consider it null and void if that's the case, because they can't just sublease it to just any company.
Exactly.
And I'm not saying they're bad. I mean, it could be
the court legally they didn't sublet it. I think they hired a management firm, so it's really the chiefs are the ones that sublet, and that was approved by this body. Mm-hmm. They hired a management firm to come in and to manage it on their behalf.
And then they were using it for a different use, as I recall.
No, same thing.
Right. Mm-hmm. If I may, the difficulty, however, with that is that the management firm actually seemed to think that they were like taking over everything. So there was a lack of clarity with regard to that. And so that's why we had a lot of the difficulty. And frankly, it should not have been done the way it was done.
So if it was written tight, then we should probably enforce it a lot better than if that's the case.
Yeah, but I think the main concern was enforcing it. We wanted to make sure we kept this company, because this company we saw as being a good prospect. And that was part of the difficulty. Because they were really having problems with the chiefs.
Right.
And so there was a bit of a, I think that the Parks and Recreation Director did a very good job with this, because it was a very kind of complex, tricky sort of situation, because essentially you could find yourself enforcing it against the chiefs, losing this other company, and then having Family Entertainment Properties having no real way to basically end up taking care of everything. And that's why I believe that he exercised his discretion in terms of administration in that way, which I think was a prudent way to end up approaching this.
Okay, thank you.
You'll keep us informed going forward.
Definitely.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please state aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? The ayes have it. The next item on the agenda is the first reading of proposed ordinance H-1603, driving while license suspended.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilwoman Horvath.
Could I ask Corp Counsel a question?
Please.
This is all legalese, so I should have asked you today when I called you. You're saying in here that we adopt the ordinance on an emergency basis. Can you tell me what this is?
Basically, what the legislature did is they ended up eliminating one requirement in terms of the state law. So our current ordinance
is pertaining to driving while license is suspended.
That's correct. So they ended up changing that and made it immediately effective. And so it's already effective. And essentially, we still have the elements, but we have an extra element. But there is an additional issue that administratively makes it more difficult now if this isn't immediately put into effect for certain individuals in terms of being able to prove things up. And that's why I wanted, in other words, getting certain records from the Secretary of State, because they don't want to do those records anymore. So that's why this needs to be done.
Well,
it should be done, it should be a first and second reading and considered to be effective on publication.
Chairman.
Councilwoman Horvath.
Then I move that the ordinance amending City Code Section 32-373 regarding driving while licenses suspended be considered read for the first, second, and third time and published due to the emergency basis of the ordinance as outlined in 11A.
Second.
Second by Councilman Musket. Any discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor of the motion, please state aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? The ayes have it. The next item on the agenda is the first reading of proposed ordinance H-1604, impersonation of officers and other types of officials.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilman Kaczynski.
I move the council concur that this ordinance be read for the first time.
Is there support?
Support.
Support by Councilwoman Clayton. Any discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor of the motion, please state aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. The next item on the agenda is business renewals for Irwin's Auto Sales and the Carl Stitt Post.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilwoman Horvath.
Council approved the renewal applications for Irwin Auto Sales on Van Born Road and the Carl E. Stitt Post on Military in Dearborn Heights as outlined in 13A.
Second.
Second by Councilman Kaczynski. Any discussion? Jack, how is Irwin's Auto? They're got fewer cars there and not using that side street.
Yeah, the side street's been good. I mean, we still have to visit the actual site pretty frequently.
But they've been more in compliance?
They were. We ended up
going to
the court with it.
Great. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please state aye.
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 Those opposed? The ayes have it. The next item on the agenda is the Class C liquor license approval for Nicholas Getzeris, 22426 Van Born.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilwoman Horvath.
I move that the council approve the attached resolution in 13B for the issuance of a Class C license to 22426 Van Born, Mr. Nicholas Getzeris.
Second.
A second sure. By Councilman Kaczynski. Any discussion? Councilman sure. Abdullah.
This is for Clerk Walt. I had a question. One of the things that we discussed at one of the meetings a while back, we talked about where everything had to be up to date as far as taxes are concerned, as far as the building and safety department, ordinance, etc. In this particular case, one of the emails that we received from you, it showed that and I'm not trying to embarrass them because I know it's public record, obviously, but there was an issue with the taxes with the county. What's the situation with that, and how does that affect us from approving this license? Because as I recall, it was like, I think it was 2014 and 15, if I'm not mistaken, the county taxes had not been paid. Is that correct?
Here, I got it here.
That's correct. I'm going to have to defer that to the treasurer because that was his findings on his part of the investigation. So,
John, yeah, does this say 2014? It looks like 2014 and 2014 again. You probably meant 15. Real property taxes are due to Wayne County, total $41,000.
I don't. Is that in our packets?
That was in the.
It was
email.
In the email.
Okay. Yeah, I did not see that email. So I
it's the one Walt with the picture
the
of the treasurer.
You gave to me.
Let me
hand it down to you.
It was specifically one with the
well,
picture.
Mr. Chairman and City Council, normally we're most concerned about the taxes that are the personal property that the city is responsible for collecting. You know, if this particular new owner wants to go into this business and there's some real property taxes that are delinquent at Wayne County, they're going to, you know, before they build and construct on this site, they're going to take care of those taxes. But normally when we come before you, it's regarding the delinquent personal property taxes. And so these taxes are at Wayne County. So actually, the city has been made whole on these taxes. And so the taxes dispute is not with the city at all, but with the county. But the way that the forms were drafted by legal, you know, we were responding, you know, with a complete, you know, what we were aware of.
Right. The only concern that I've got, I mean, I know in a perfect world everybody would pay their taxes and everything would be up to date and what have you. The concern that I've gotten, yes, it makes sense. Nobody would open up a business and then be behind in their taxes and have their property foreclosed on. But at the same time, the reality is people do get foreclosed on. So I'm just concerned, I don't know, if there was a way that we could do it in a way where those taxes are paid first before we give a final approval on this, I think it'd be more in our favor.
I think what happened is he leased the property to an operator, and the operator didn't pay the taxes, and so they're in arrears. And if he doesn't pay them soon, he'll lose title to the property.
There's one more year left, because 3 years.
Right.
Mr. Chair?
Councilman, or Councilor Miyake?
Yes. The way in which the new applications for new licenses are handled is it's very discretionary with this body. All right. In other words, this body is not in a position where it has to end up giving someone a new license, and it was specifically drafted that way. So if you want to say basically like, look, we'll table this, take care of those taxes, even though the city has been made whole, the issue becomes whether or not you're going to give a new license to some entity, and then that entity is going to potentially not be able to handle things responsibly because they're going to end up losing their real property. So that is a possibility, Councilman, of a way to do it, is just to say, look, table it, and then bring it back when they end up having...
And even if it's a difficulty as far as the pay, I mean, as you are aware, you can make arrangements with payments, or at least pay that 1 year, the last year that's due, pay that 1 year, and then you're out of the foreclosure process at the minimal.
So there are ways to basically deal with that, but if those taxes are unpaid, the point is if you're concerned about the viability of a business because they haven't paid their taxes, then that is something that you could at least at the moment say, look, you need to take care of that and then bring it back if you wanted to do that.
Now
it's discretionary with this body.
Now the operator of the building and the business is the same as the owner. So if he doesn't pay the taxes, that license won't be good for at that location. But I think what happened is he leased it and the former operator got behind.
And if you look also on this particular document, you know, we looked at this back at the end of April, and so I did not revisit this since, you know, my initial review of that. So it's possible that some of that, I don't want to say that they are because I have not looked at it since, you know, the end of April.
It's the business, it's 41,000.
Right, that's exactly my point. The amount on that, and that's where the concern was. The amount when I looked at it was, and again, it's public record. It was up there. It was 40-some thousand. So it's not something that could be paid for sure.
Right, and Council Chair,
Councilor Miyake.
Yes, the city clerk was kind of giving me a knowing look from his side of the table, and that's. That's kind of one of the points, that this is not necessarily, if you think, well, they won't be able to handle the business there, it's like, yes, and then you've just given up one of the few remaining licenses that you have to someone who will potentially be able to just transfer it automatically, practically, to another location, potentially outside the city, in which case you've given a valuable license to a business that's not necessarily going to keep that valuable item in this city. That's one of the reasons why the ordinance was written the way it was to make sure that you as a body can say, look, we want to end up having certain conditions on this because this is a valuable commodity that we're providing to you, and we want to make sure that it enhances the city the best it can.
Any further discussion?
Now I'm really confused. I hate to admit it, but I'm confused.
Well,
what are we going to do here?
Again, so the owner of the building, there was a former operator, I think under the lease agreement, he was supposed to pay the taxes. He didn't.
The gentleman that's on this form.
No, the prior operator,
okay.
the tenant, he didn't pay him, so he foreclosed and he took over the building. So now he's fixing the building up, but he's going to... John, you'll check to see if those property taxes have been paid. He's got to pay those taxes or the county could foreclose.
I understand all that, but so is the motion okay or should we withdraw the motion until we get it cleaned up? I don't know what to do.
Taxes are such that there's so much, he may not be able to get any money until he gets the business up and running and operating. It's the taxes are quite substantial.
Chair, I'd like to propose if we could, I'm sorry.
Okay.
Go ahead, Mayor.
I will rescind my motion to pass this, and who seconded?
I did.
Okay, Joe.
Well.
And then I will move to put it to a study session.
Or table it.
Or table it until we get a clarification.
Sorry, yeah.
Let me ask this question. The license is going to one person?
Yeah, it would go to him as the licensee.
Yeah, the tax liability is somebody else's responsibility. So if you give this man, I'm sorry.
It is still his responsibility.
Yeah, and it's his wife who's the licensee, as I recall.
Well.
On the foreman.
If he's allowed to conduct the business under Class C license, he may have a source of revenue to catch up on this.
That's what I'm saying.
You catch up on the potential for foreclosure. So I think there's positive on both ends of it to go forward and authorize the license and let the chips fall where they may. If it turns out that as long as we're not put into a liability situation.
There won't be a problem in terms of liability. It's
okay,
really more a matter of the concerns that I pointed out.
Mr. Chair.
Previously.
Councilman Musket. I'm in concurrence with our corporate counsel, Miyake, about tabling this right along with Dave Abdullah, because if we give up this license, it's a valuable license. Mm-hmm. And I would think that he would have to start making something whole before we grant this to him. So I think we should table it so we can find out if he plans on paying us or if he's paid anything toward it. I mean, this is why we had everything written up the way it was written up. So I concur with Dave to table it.
Yeah, and if I may clarify, this is based on the Wayne County records. The 2014 taxes, which is total owed, including interest and fees, is $22,868, which has not been paid. And then you got 2015, which is $18,293, for a total of $41,161. They are already 2 years behind. Once you get the third year, as the council would tell you, you lose the property. And it's already, it says on here, status subject to foreclosure. Now, I want businesses coming into the Van Bourne area more than anybody, of course. But we just want to make sure, I personally, I'd like to recommend that we just table it until he just makes some sort of arrangement with the county to where he's not subject to foreclosure. And then I have no problem approving him at that particular point.
There was Councilwoman Horvath's motion. So you amend your motion to table it. Is there support?
Second.
Support.
Seconded by Councilman Musket. Any further discussion?
Well, there's no discussion on tabling.
No.
Simply, you're delaying the situation for an opportunity to develop the business there.
Get the business running and generate some revenue to pay
exactly.
The taxes.
We're all concerned about getting Van Bourne up and running with regard to potential for being a good business trip. And here you're putting a wedge in a way, in a sense of delaying this man's opportunity to begin to develop some funding to pay that, get that revenue to go to the destination of correcting this situation. We have no say as to how he's going to do this. If we're going to lose the license by virtue of making this a decision and delaying it, nothing is accomplished.
Yeah, the license is personal to him, so if he doesn't get the license approved, he can't, if he later loses the building, he can't really do anything with that license.
Well, can he take the license elsewhere?
Yes.
And open a business somewhere?
Yeah.
Yeah, see, that's not good. You're going to lose the license for the city and take it to Lincoln Park or Taylor or wherever. Yeah, I don't like that idea.
Well,
he'd sell the license.
He can sell the liquor license.
Mm-hmm. Are you suggesting that this is a strategy to get the
license? No, I'm not suggesting that at all. But, I mean, you're saying, you know, for him to get his business up and running, what's it take for him to go pay these tax? If he's getting the business.
41 grand.
Well, he can go make arrangements and show us that he's making arrangements to get it done.
Well, he could pay the last year due.
Yeah, which was $18,000.
He'd be out of foreclosure for
correct.
1 year.
Right now he's in foreclosure, so.
Or actually $22,000, almost $23,000. If he doesn't have it to reach into his pocket to, you know, that's
We give him the license, then he can't make his taxes, then he takes the license with him wherever he goes, and we lose the license.
Okay. Mr. Chairman?
Councilwoman Horvath.
I just want to make a point here. Mr. Gasteris is not the man that owes the taxes. He's not the guy that owes the taxes. It's the guy or the people, or he doesn't owe the taxes, right?
He owns the property, he owes the tax.
Yeah.
He owes the taxes. It's not the guy before him.
No, the taxes are basically in rem. They are based on the property. In other words, if it doesn't end up getting paid, then that property is going to end up going into foreclosure. There's going to be a forfeiture.
Okay.
Then there's going to be a foreclosure, and then it's...
The tenant, the prior tenant didn't pay the taxes, but the owner is ultimately liable.
Okay, got it.
Any further discussion? It's been moved and supported to table this to find out the status of the taxes. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Those opposed? The ayes have it. That ends the regular portion of our meeting. Is there any announcements from anybody at
Mr.
the table?
Mr. Chairman.
Councilwoman Lisa Explain.
Thank you. I have one announcement. The U.S. Army and Michigan District of Kiwanis will be hosting a leadership conference on Saturday, June 18th, 9 a.m. to noon at the Richard A. Young Center, which is 5400 McKinley, Dearborn Heights. This opportunity is open to all high school students to develop leadership skills, problem solving, conflict resolution, and team building. It is a no-cost leadership conference. So we want to invite all of our high school students. If you're interested in attending, please call 313-348-9848. Thank you.
Any other announcements from anybody at the table? Clerk Persevich?
Two announcements. First of all, hopefully you have received your Dearborn Heights today, and we in the clerk's office have provided a two-page spread about voting upcoming in the August and November election. Please take a look at that, and if our office can be of any assistance, we will. We want to make the next two elections as smooth for the people in line as possible. Also, we are going to be filming a an informative video on voting and what you need to know before you come in and so forth. That will be running on the cable station. Mr. Guarnello, do we have a slot yet?
Yes, we do. Currently, we have two slots open, either 12 and 6 or 2:30 and 8:30. And then, of course, depending on the running of the council meeting, we can take it after that.
So that is 12 and 6 or 2:30 and 8:30. So that'll be filmed next Tuesday, and as soon as it's edited, it'll be prepared. And please take a look at it. If you have any questions, please call my office, 313-791-3432. One other. It'll also be on the YouTube channel. Also, one other thing I want to mention. Counselor, stop me if I say anything improper, but I think I'm within. We've been receiving numerous complaints about some solicitors going door to door. They are an energy company. The complaints that I have been receiving is that anywhere from their representing themselves as being representatives of the city of Dearborn Heights, very strong arm tactics, banging on doors after hours. I got a call from a lady 2 days in a row that they just wouldn't give up. I even got a report that they entered somebody's house. So for your protection, people, please, first of all, I would advise you not to let anybody in your house. Secondly, I did call the Attorney General's office today to see if we could do any kind of complaint. And the reason I'm mentioning is this so I can get into what the chief and I discussed today, and they are reluctant to do anything. They said that's not within their scope of authority. So I talked to the chief and I met today, and chief, please add anything if you'd like. These people should have licenses from the city of Dearborn Heights. They should have pictures. You do not you should be able to say no thank you and at that. If they pressure you, bang on your door after hours, please call the police. The police have responded already, and the chief has assured me they will. Please be careful what you're giving them, what you're providing them with. Protect yourself. So just a word of warning, and I think this is all we can do as a city to protect you, but please be aware that this is going on.
Mr. Chairman, if I may also echo other idea, which is that these individuals are not affiliated with the city of Dearborn Heights. We have no city public utility for the sale of natural gas, and if they try to represent that, then we also need to be made aware of that. The police department should be made aware of that, because that would be basically potentially misrepresenting themselves. And you just did a first reading on the impersonation ordinance, and that could be covered under that.
Yeah, 10% of the utility market is still choice, so you get calls or people soliciting to sign people up. Chief Gavin?
And that's what these solicitors are looking for. They're asking to see a copy of your last bill. If they get it and they can get your account number, they can transfer over some gas recovery costs, and then talking to some DTE representatives, it's hard to get it back out of, you know, that company's name. So just don't give them any bills when they knock on your door. They want to see a latest DTE bill, gas bill. So just don't show it to them. And give us a call. We've had numerous calls. They're knocking late at night, trying to force their way in the house. They know if an elderly couple answers, they have a better chance of getting in. So just don't answer the door for them.
And obviously, if someone wants to use their services, then certainly they could. But if they don't, you have every right not to do so, and the city is not sanctioning them to do any of this.
So proceed with caution. Thank you.
Question.
Councilwoman Horvath?
I don't know where to go with this. I keep getting these calls from the IRS with a case number. And every time they call, it's a different number that they call, but it's the same case number. Now, and I just tell them I work for the IRS, and they hang up on me. Now, I got the Department of the Treasury calling me. Case number, call them, otherwise they're going to arrest me. Where do I go with this?
Yeah, it's a scam, because
it's constant.
They only send letters, they don't call.
Well, I know that.
I think you should contact the federal government, the IRS.
Okay.
Or the FBI.
Most of these calls, I received them many times. They are from out of the country. None of them comes from this.
Well, the original call, the original call is here. It's you're right. What they do is they call and they say, I'm Mary from the IRS, and your case number, da-da-da-da-da, and you must contact your attorney of record immediately, or you're going to be arrested because this is a very da-da, and they leave a telephone number, and they hang up. Well, then you call that number, and you get out
of the
offshore,
country.
Right.
Yeah.
And that's when because you can't talk to that first person. It's a recording of some kind. And then that's when I say, I work for the IRS, and they hang up right away. But I get them 3 or 4 or 5 times a day sometimes. And now they've got me the Treasury Department.
Yeah, I talked to a senior a couple of years ago that paid like $16,000, ran out and transferred the money out of the account.
Geez.
It was gone. It's gone out of the country. So that the IRS or the Michigan Department of Treasury only sends
all the phone numbers,
sends
and
letters
that they call with, you know, the
they don't email and they don't call you.
No, I know they don't. I know that.
And also, I want to point out, through the internet, they're able to get local numbers. So even though it's from a whole other country, they will get a 313 or a 248 number to make it look more legitimate. That's off the internet.
These are not local 313s. These are like 630, which is
right.
Illinois. And
yeah, I've got them from Washington, D.C.
I'll take your advice. Okay.
I've received them from Cincinnati and Washington, D.C. And I had one guy in the line for 20 minutes talking to him, telling him, oh, please don't take me to jail. And then finally I says, well, you know, if you want to collect, you're going to have to come over and get it. And I just hung up. Never called back.
Thank you.
Okay. That's it.
Thank you. Any further announcements from anyone? Mike? Director McCafferty? Library Director McCafferty?
Good idea.
Pretty good deal. Hello, Council Chair and Mayor. I wanted to talk about a couple of upcoming events at the library. First off, our summer reading kickoff parties. Carolyn Kennedy Library will start the festivities next Friday, June 24th from 1 to 3 p.m. And John F. Kennedy Library, Saturday, June 25th from 1 to 3 p.m. We will have games, treats, crafts, and children, teens, and adults can all register and earn rewards. We will have 6 weeks of special programs to encourage reading and summer activity. Programs run through through August 6th. The summer reading program is sports themed this year with the kids program entitled On Your Mark, Get Set, Read. Should be fun and hope to see you there. Also next Tuesday, June 21st at Carolyn Kennedy Library from 7 to 8:30 p.m. we will feature a program on biking. Rob Pulsifer, the author of Best Bike Rides Detroit and Ann Arbor and Dirt Road Washtenaw, will share his passion for the outdoors in a program that combines photos, history, and discussion about great places to bike in Southeast Michigan and beyond. That's all for now. Thank you for your time and see you at the library.
Thank you.
Mike, thank you.
All right, you're welcome.
Director McIntyre.
Good evening, Council.
Good evening.
I wanted to just kind of update folks on the sweeps that we started several weeks back. We've completed three now, and I'm pleased to tell you that every area that we've gone into, we've seen a real noticeable difference. People out cleaning up, painting garages, getting things done that have been kind of put on the back burner for years. So we were very pleased about that. This past Friday, I just want to kind of acknowledge some folks that I'm not going to say their names, but we opened it up to employees that could walk along with the ordinance officers to help do the paperwork part of it. So we had a nice turnout last Friday. We're going to be doing sweep 5 and 6 next week. That's Telegraph to Beach, Annapolis to Van Bourne, and then Beach Daily to Inkster, Annapolis to Van Bourne. That area, Beach Daily to Inkster, Annapolis to Van Bourne, those letters are going out this week. So people basically are getting a letter. It's giving them about 3 weeks notice to let them know that we're going to be in the area. We're going to be looking for violations on the property, and we're going to be talking to them. We issued very few tickets. So mostly we've had lots of conversations. Last Friday we had lots of people applauding and clapping while some of the groups were walking on the street. So it's been very well received. So I'm pleased to announce that. I want to remind people on June 25th here at City Hall, June 25th, Saturday from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. is our, we're hosting our low-cost vaccination clinic. MHS, Michigan Humane Society, is putting it on. Vaccines are $5. Rabies vaccinations are $5. Microchips will be available for $10. It's a considerable savings for most people. Licenses for Dearborn Heights residents will be available that day. I want to announce this. MHS asked me to announce this. This is not just for Dearborn Heights residents. So if you know anybody in your family, it's open to anyone that wants to come. Wayne County, Oakland County, it doesn't matter. You can bring your animal, dog or cat only. If you have a unique animal that requires vaccinations, contact MHS. Let them know what kind of unique animal that is. They are allowed to come that day, but you have to get permission ahead of time, and they also have to make sure that the vaccination that they have is suitable to that particular animal. Some folks last year showed up with some slithering animals, and we don't vaccinate them. So we still are asking for some folks to come and volunteer that day. Please call me directly if you can come out and volunteer between 9 a.m. and 1 p.m. on Saturday. Mostly you'll just be sitting at the receiving table where you check folks' ID. Decipher which line they need to get into for which type of vaccination or microchip. You can call me directly at 313-791-3478. That's it.
Mr.
Director
Chairman.
Director McIntyre, thank you.
Just a
Councilwoman Lisa Clayton.
Thank you. Question for Director McIntyre. With the ordinance sweeps, I think they're very successful. And I know there have been a lot of calls. You're doing citations, giving people a chance to clean up their properties, which is good. Have you been able to develop any resources for those like who are disabled or senior citizens that may not be able to, they don't have the access to resources or they're not able to do it themselves? Any word on that to provide support to those individuals?
So we have a program through our community development department. Mm-hmm. Folks can call there. I just talked to Chris today. There was one resident that called that was worried about two slabs of cement in front of her house. We went out there and looked at it. We didn't feel like it was an emergency situation, but we directed her to CDBG. She's gotten the paperwork's being mailed to her. She'll fill it out, and it could be a couple months before they get through that process. If it's of a more emergency nature, it has to be taken. We have to deal with it right then and there. So,
all right, thank you.
Okay,
Director McIntyre, thank you. Any other announcements? Hearing none, if there's any comments from any of our residents, please come up to the microphone, state the street you live on, and your name. Mr. Zuhair Abdelhak.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
I just want to wish everybody happy Ramadan, and I hope peace will come to this city and this country during this month and every day the whole year. I noticed for the last couple of years there is lots of items you go and put it on a study session. I believe there is more than a dozen issues you sent to study session, but I never seen anything came back to this table to be discussed. Is there any rules in our charter or the city council rules or anything which gives the city council or our mayor specific time to bring this subject back? It seems to me any time you put something to go to study session, it's like you sending it to the graveyard where it doesn't come back.
Well, if something's referred to a study session, we have the study session, and then whatever that item is, it's something we have to pass, like on this gentleman's liquor license, we're going to check and see if his taxes have been paid or not, and he's going to have to get them caught up or make arrangements, or he's not going to get his liquor license. So it's depends on the issue. If the issue's pressing, then, yeah, if it needs council approval, it's got to come back. But there's no rule that says.
I believe there are some pressing subjects like the negotiation, the contract negotiation. If you are waiting until the negotiation is done, then I understand. But this is very pressing issue. You need to take care of it because there are lots of subjects, you know, need to discuss it, like conflict of interest, from what I heard. I don't know if it is true or not, but I would like that to be discussed.
We have a study session coming up this Tuesday.
Okay.
On the that issue.
But it's closed.
A closed study session.
And sometimes, and I can't think of anything right off the top of my head, sometimes some of the things that go to the study session get resolved. I can't think of an example, but sometimes we go to a study session, we talk about something, and then somehow or other it just gets resolved. It doesn't necessarily have to get on the agenda. In fact, it's funny you should ask that because I had Denise give me a copy of the
open items,
and I tried to find any from my previous years, but I must have thrown them away. But sometimes, rare, not all the time, but sometimes in a few cases, it resolves itself and it goes away. But we are going to have a study session this week on
it would be nice if we, the public, know about it. We don't wonder what happened to it.
Sale of real estate, personnel items, contract negotiations just by their nature, because it's, we don't, the other side, if it's public, if we're selling a piece of property, the price, that has to be in a closed session. But otherwise, yes, it will be public.
I just wish, you know, that we know about it so we don't wonder what happened to it. That's all. And to piggyback on your issue, Marge, I have received calls that I owe money on my DTE energy, and if I don't pay to Instagram, they ask you to go put money in Instagram, and they call you back and they get the number where you put the money and they withdraw it, and it's not DTE. And you get letters that you won the lotto in Europe, and they hit normally the senior citizens,
yeah,
mainly. And yeah. Some guy in Dearborn was taken for, I think, $9,000. He kept sending money and waiting for the $500,000 he won. He never seen it. And you get from the IRS, you get from all kind of things. All those are scams. And our residents should be aware that all these calls, unless there is a letter, there is something in your hand from authority or a company, those are scams. They should be careful about it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Have blessed
Mr. Chair. Thank you.
Chair.
Councilwoman.
Mr. Abdelhak made me think of something on the open item list for study sessions that I think is possibly pressing. What it was, the used car lot ordinance, the amendment that was brought forth a little while ago by the Planning and Zoning Commission, and it was tabled to study session. And the reason I'm bringing that forward is I had a discussion with some members of our TIFA who said there are several influx, uptick, so to speak, of applications for used car lots along the Van Bourne corridor, which was the whole purpose of that ordinance amendment that TIFA, as well as the Planning Commission, had worked on for over a year. So I was wondering if that is something that we can give a priority to, because what's going to happen is if those used car lots are approved, you know, they're there where this is, the amendment was for special use permit would be required.
Yeah, part of that was going to contain a dispersal requirement. Am I correct in remembering that Mark Roberts is working on the final draft of the ordinance?
Yeah, that is my my memory with regard to this as well, that Mark was working on that, and I believe that there still was work to be done with the Planning Commission itself. For some reason, my understanding was that they were still going to be looking at it, but I could be wrong about that.
So I'll get with the Assistant Corporation Counsel, Mark Roberts, and see what the status of that is.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair.
Councilman Musket.
Going back on that statement about used car lots, I think I have a question for Mr. McIntyre. Lately, I've reported about cars unlicensed being sold at a particular residence. This is obviously the guy's running a used car lot out of his driveway. It's constantly the same house, different cars all the time. What is the fine for that?
Yeah, it's you know, there's, it depends on how the ticket's written. If it's unlawful storage, it would be a $200 ticket, but then it would be at the judge's discretion.
But I mean, he's selling vehicles from there. This is, you know,
you're
see traffic
about on Midway.
Yeah. And this is not the first time, second, third, or fourth time. When do we stop this from happening? I mean, neighbors have complained. I shouldn't say neighbors. People in the neighborhood complained about the traffic that stops there all the time. Sometimes you can't even get around them. People are looking at cars. I mean, this is not a used car lot. This is a residential area. I've contacted your office, so I don't know what kind of fines we can put on somebody or how heavy a fine we can put on someone. But if we charge them a $50 ticket for a vehicle that's worth $3,000 or $4,000, this guy's going to make, he'll pay a $50 ticket any day of the week.
Well,
Councilor Reacki.
Thank you. These are municipal civil infractions. If we're in a position where we can end up establishing it and satisfying the judge that it's an ongoing problem, we can actually get equitable relief. In other words, we can get an order from the court prohibiting that activity from taking place. Now, years ago, we had a person who was operating a dance studio out of her home, and we had to go through an elaborate amount of work, but we were able to establish to the satisfaction of one of the judges that indeed this was a unlawful dance studio, and we got an order prohibiting that from taking place. But it was almost like a sting operation. You know, the ordinance officer had to call and say, hey, I understand you've got, you know, what do I do? Send me information and all the rest of this stuff to basically establish that that's what this individual is doing. Otherwise, you know, the people who are doing it are not going to cooperate. And people in the neighborhood can just say, yeah, I saw this car going up here, and that's not normally going to be enough to satisfy the judge.
Well, so. I understand that, but I mean, how many times do you have to keep going out there with somebody having cars, different cars with no plates and for sale signs on them?
It might be necessary to do something more elaborate, but I would not want to discuss that in a public forum.
Thank you. Thank you, Director.
Anything further?
Move to adjourn.
Moved and support. Seconded by Councilman Musket. Good evening, everyone.
Hey, John, did you...